I will speak from 1941 until 1979, which forces and which classes are and which political parties they were competing. And then by 1979, revolution and the alliances between the different political forces, Khomeini, Mujahideen al-Khaliq, and all others. The 1980 election, the majlis after the revolution, the defeat of the Mujahideen al-Khaliq, the Iraq-Iran war, a bit I will speak, the tactic and the strategies of Khomeini, and then the end of the war, 1988, the days of Khomeini, Iran signing the ceasefire with Iraq to stop the war, the coming of Rafsanjani, after him, the coming of Rabbani, and then Ahmadinejad, and after that, Rouhani within Iran, and Iran's relation with imperialism, first Russian Tsarist imperialists from the north and British from the south, then defeat of Mossadegh, and the defeat of the British in Iran and American imperialism taking over, the defeat of American imperialism and the beginning of the new Iran under Khomeini, and Iran in the region. Finally, we will conclude 11 September, the Afghanistan war, 2003 Iraq war, what brought to Iran, and little bit the regional war which is happening in Syria and the position in Iran. And we will leave it to them for discussion which way Iran will go. It's very extensive, so I will make it short in 1 hour to finish it. It is not very easy. Iran became a Muslim state after the Shah of Iran was defeated in the Battle of Basra in the time of the Caliph Umar, the second Caliph. Gradually, Iran became a Muslim country. This continued, and then in the 16th century, a new forces came to take over the power with alliance with certain Shiite ideologue, and as I have distributed for you the nationalities in Iran, Iran is, first of all, is a multinational country and a multi-ethnic country. I want you to see in the graph I gave to you. The most important, after the Safaviyin in the 16th century took over the power and systematically Iran became a Shiite state. Then the Afghan war, the Afghans' invasion to Iran, coming until Tehran and toppling the Safaviyin, and gradually the building or the coming of the Qajars in power. The Qajars are very small minority nationality within Iran, and you see they only constitute Iran, have three groups of languages, as you see in the name there, in the, I don't know, for those people who have the paper. The first is called the Iranians, those who are speaking Indo-European languages. There are, the biggest nationality out of them is the Farsi speaking, the Persians. Then you have the Kurd. Then you have the Baluchis, who live also in Pakistan and little bit in Afghanistan, but more in Pakistan and Iran. Then you have the Mazandarans, another also Indo-European language speakers. Then the Khilaks, also they are Indo-European speakers. The Lurs, the Talishi, which one important Sufi leader, Abdul Qadir al-Kailani, came from them. Very important group in Islamic history. I'm not going to dwell on that. And then you have the Hazara, which now majority of them live in Afghanistan. The Afghans who speak the Dari, which is an old Persian language, and small others. This is one group which spoke Indo-European languages. Then you have the Turkish speaking people. The biggest group of them is the second biggest nationality, the Azeris, which live in Iran, the second biggest nationality, and they live also in Azerbaijan. They are Turkish speaking, Iranis, and they are Shia. Then you have the Qashqis, the Shfans, Turkoman, Temur, Afshars, Jashid, and others. All these are Turkish speaking people within Iran. Then you have the Arabs, which they live in the south, with Iraqi border. Once they used to call the area Arabistan. And then the non-Muslims, you have the Assyrian Christians, the old Coptic Christians, the Armenians, the Jewish, the old Iranian religion, the Zoroastrians, and the Baha'i. This is the major nationalities in Iran. Strangely, Iran ruled after the Safavid. The Safavid in the 16th century, after the defeat of the Safavid by the Afghan war, the Safavid are Turkish-speaking group who have ruled Iran until 17-something, and then they were overthrown by the Afghan invasion. They came with the support of the Qajaris, and you see here the Qajaris. In the second group, you see the Qajars, which there are only 30,000 people at that moment, and they became by 1850 about 40,000, eloquent group, ruled Iran for a very long time. Why I do that? The Iran, you understand, and you were told, is bigger than what it is inside Iran. Is a multinational, multilingual, majority Shiite, a minority Sunnite, good group Sunnite, and then you have small Jewish, Armenians, Orthodox, and Assyrians, and so on. The Qajars played important role two times. One time by bringing the Safavid in the 16th century in power. And after the collapse of the Safavid in the 18th century, the Qajars took over Iran. Until their collapse and overthrown by the officer, an army man, Reza Shah, the father of the Pahlavi Muhammad Shah. Iran was a subcontinent country. When the Qajar took over, even though Iran have never been colonized by external force and in a very old civilization, majority of the villages, they didn't know each other. There was no roads. Is a pre-capitalist feudal state, what Karl Marx called it the Asiatic mode of production. There was no road, people didn't know each other. If a foreigner came to visit a village, the whole village would run away. A modern nation is a creation of the bourgeoisie, and it is as we have seen it in European history with the French Revolution. When the French Revolution happened and the ancient regime disappeared and they ran away as refugees, the villages around Paris, they only knew that the king disappeared after 1 year. You can imagine that there is no even road and communication. They were singing Vive la Roi, he was already gone. There was no road, there was nothing, and Iran also in this way. What are the strategies of the Qajars to rule Iran then? Divide and rule. When they face big enemy, they retreat, and they regroup again, divide communally. Once they divide, when an uprising comes against them or something, using communal tensions, tribal tensions, and religious tensions. They don't have any vision of building a new nation on the basis of a modern nation as we know. After a while, Tsarist imperialism was developing from the north. Britain, frightened by this expansionist Tsarist policy, went 3 times in war with Afghanistan. British vision from the south, it took over Bahrain in 1820. It encircled, feared that it is Russian imperialism, Tsarist imperialism, will come down to the sea. And that was the slogan of the Tsarist imperialist: our soldiers must wash their boot in the Indian Ocean. And British strategy was to put Afghanistan as a buffer zone between her and the most important colony, India. The Qajars, they were defeated by Russians, Tsarist imperialism. Tsarist imperialists with modern equipment, with new technology, defeated this archaic empire of the Qajars. In that defeat, now we are speaking the development of capitalism comes in that way, Iran lost 2 significant provinces of her to the Russians, Armenia and Georgia. It had always been part of the great Russian, great Iranian Empire. The loss of Armenia and Georgia in one side, the treatment, the agreement, I will not mention the name of the agreement, is not important, that Russian imperialism imposed on the Qajars, they have to open the door of the market of Iran. One, used the army, defeated the Qajars, then went into the second policy of diplomacy. It is not a diplomacy of equals, it is between the defeated and the winner. And in that diplomatic accord, that Russian business, Russian business people, they can do business wherever they want in Iran, and they will not pay also tariffs or tax to the government of Iran. Thirdly, also, they will not accept any Russian to be treated and brought into court of the Sharia court. The base of the court was the Sharia court. Gradually, Russian capitalist and Russian investment and Russian commodities was penetrating. British imperialism, so frightened with this influence, from the south it invaded also. Even though to weaken and fear of the Russians, we will not speak as a result of that, the Tsarist Russia, that the 3 times the British war against Afghanistan, until the last one was 1918. Britain wanted to protect India. India is the most important colony in the job. In the process, gradually, the capitalist development and road establishment and so on, the introduction of postage, the introduction of telegraphs and so on, this brought a sort of a unity among the different parts of Iran. What are the classes that they exist in Iran then? You have the notables, you have the bazaar, The bazaar bourgeoisie, the bazaar is a very important economic factor in Iranian history until today. The bazaar is, in one time, is a shopping mall. On the other side is also, it is a bank which gives loan to the government. The bazaar, because of the connection and the telecommunication capacity and the telegraph and the telephone coming, I'm now shorting it, coming and so on, all bazaaris, every city have its bazaar, they could make a connection among themselves. The bazaars are, some of them, partially from the landlord, at the same time they are business people. For very long time they exist within that, what Karl Marx says, the new or the Asian mode of production, and they are very important middle class or the bourgeoisie, you could say, of that system. They give loan, they have connection with the craftsmen, they produce, they have land, agricultural land, they produce a lot of other, and they have also small cottage industries. The infiltration of imperialism in general, and specific Russian imperialism from the north, and British imperialism competing it from the south, both of them want to dominate and to turn Iran into a semi-colony or semi-dependent country. And this angered a very nationalist country, in a sense of old. It angered the different classes in the society. One, the bazaar class, which had been the most dominant one, cannot compete with these new goods. And one time, there was even a revolt of the tobacco revolt. The second is that it is, of course, there is a peasantry in the country, landless peasantry, semi-landless peasantry, which is dominated also by the agas, the khan, the tribal chiefs, and the bazaaris in general. In the process, with this modernization continuing, and the Enlightenment started developing in Iran, the second Shah who came after it replaced this within the Qajars, he have seen and learned a little bit from the concept of Tanzimat of the Turk, wants to modernize his army and wants to modernize the country. And it have taken a carbon copy of the Turkish modernization system. It opened a permanent mission in two countries, in France and UK. And of course, in this process, new classes also start gradually in the embryo level, start developing. One, the enlightened, educated class who have been sent outside, studied, come back, brought the concept of the French Revolution, the Enlightenment, the fraternity, equality, and so on, and so on, and so on. And they brought with them also the bourgeois ideology of liberalism, in one side. They wanted a modern state. You have this group was gradually developing, and because of their ideas, they started building the new library in Tehran. They started trying to publish and to say that we should bring a modern education. Education was dominated by the mullahs and by the rural religious schools, which are very important, a very strong class. They wanted to modernize. So there is a conflict between this and the bazaar and the old mullah class. You see here that they wanted to change the nature of the state. Finally, by the pressure, the concept of majlis came. Majlis means it's a parliament in the Arabic world. And men was demanding that it is must be a parliament, we must have a sovereign parliament. And the Qajar Shah, the second and the third, they start weakening, while imperialism also infiltrating with its good, with its ideas, with this and so on, and becoming strong economically dominating. And the main concurrent to imperialist capital, it is the bazaar capital. The bazaar capital had been marginalized, and its role was taken, even though the constitution of the country, not constitution, but the administration and the law was the Sharia law until today. This development forced Majlis and from every social classes, particularly from the prominent social classes, people were elected, brought the bazaaris were the dominant, then you have the notables, the enlightened princes, the intelligentsia, and so on. And this time, we are not speaking about the working class and the peasantry is not represented. The new modern intelligentsia, which is developing and is doing its new missionary work for bringing the concept of the French Revolution. And of course, the Qajar power behind the screen is using one against the other. And in this debate, in a debate of the constitutional thing, first they have to have a constitutional assembly. And after the constitutional assembly, there must be a constitution must be drafted. And after that also an election commission. In that debate, it is the most important debate, you could say. They have debated a lot, and the example of the debate was on the Belgian constitution to transform Iran into the Belgian type of constitution with a kingdom. There was a long debate on the Belgian constitution there. In this debate, there are forces who say we have constitution, we are an Islamic state, the bazaars and so on. Bazaars are also not only the most important traditional bourgeoisie, but they are also connected to the religious class and indirectly also connected to most of religious peasantry, and they are also connected to the notables who are very religious. So they were dominant in this. They are saying, no, the concept is we want to, the liberals and so on, they are saying we want a kingdom where the king or the shah will be very symbolic and the parliament will be the typical bourgeois, a semi type of debate. The others, they say, no, this is have nothing to do with our history. And of course, in the same time, is imperialism also, it is an economically was penetrating and so on. Belgium Constitution 1 was the debate. Second is, the country never had taxation system. The first systematic taxation system was made by Belgium. Later on, I will give you his name. So Belgium, in a way, is interlinked to Iran's history. This, it could not materialize, it could not develop into a normal bourgeois state, and so on and so on. And in the process, there was a lot of other majlises continued. Because I have 1 hour, I have to shorten it. A lot of majlis means it is a debate for the parliament, to create the constitution and so on, and the debate. It dragged for almost 15 times of the majlis and so on. In the process, Iran was transforming, roads is open, Tehran was growing, other cities are growing, modern education gradually is coming, and so on. And different forces are start appearing. In one side, the embryo working class start coming as a result of certain industries built by foreign or by Iranian industrialists who developed, even though the most important one and the most important class, but their role is reactionary, the comprador bourgeoisie, which is linked with outside, was growing Some of them even they became big merchant families who have even moved to England and got British citizen because they have accumulated a very huge wealth. Then you have the peasantry, which is also a majority of the population. With the introduction of the capitalism slowly, which is dominated capitalism from external, with a new comprador already is developing, the little bit of national bourgeoisie, which doesn't get any support from inside, was developing. You have the bazaar bourgeoisie linked also. And then you have enlightened mullahs in one side who wanted to have a new liberal state. And then you have another mullahs who reject. They say, we have our civilization and we have our democracy. And the democracy will be an Islamic democracy and so on. So this clash is there. Qom is very important. Religious Shia school. They also very important is the student, the religious student who are coming from this school and different parts and so on. They are very active and they are very important. And they are saying that this is an infiltration of an enemy. The dress of what they are bringing, the enemy is trying to change the country, is going to destroy our tradition, is going to destroy our religion. They are exploiting our resources and so on. So in a sense, they have also a nationalist, anti-imperialist reflex because they have seen that they are also getting weaker and weaker, and the comprador bourgeoisie is slowly, slowly becoming stronger. Other element also developed. So I say liberty, socialism, ideas comes later on, and liberal ideas, and the old ideas also is there. In the process of this also, mushroom of other organization gradually developed. Capitalism, by its nature, it penetrates, it creates also a petty bourgeoisie was growing and so on, and mushroom nationalities of nationality organizations started developing. And one of the most important of it is the Azeri group, which is Azerbaijan. First of all, not only the influence in Azerbaijan, secondly, a lot of Iranian Azeris who had went to work in Baku, in Azerbaijan capital, in the oil industry. I'm shortening because we have not a lot of time. It's very lovely. I could have gone hours. I could have explained to you in details. The emergence of the social democracy, the party of Lenin in Tsarist Russia, it is influence in Azerbaijan. And this influence that there is about 100,000 Iranian Azeris also working in Azerbaijan. And they, by coming home, being conscious, creating a demand, the labor demand, 8-hour work and so on and so on. And the first social democracy party in Iran established in 1904-05. Now we have a liberal idea on one side. Now the idea of the workers are coming. We have a comprador bourgeoisie, we have the bazaar bourgeoisie, we have the peasant issue, we have the sovereignty issue. Finally, Tsarist Russia was defeated and a Bolshevik revolution happens. This relieved the Qajars from the pressure from the north. The Qajars, as I have told you, always they are using divide and rule, and they adapt to divine rule to the situation. And of course, this Bolshevik revolution in Russia and so on, these new ideas also threatened the vested interest. The bazaarists was threatened, even the liberal bourgeoisie was threatened, and so on. Everybody, imperialism is threatened, and the comprador bourgeoisie is threatened. A new motor, a new ideas was coming. So Iran entered into a different phase. While the debate continues in so-called majlis between those who want to go ahead and those who wanted to remain and say that this is an imperialist and an external. At one stage, as Marx says, When the people, they don't want to live as before, or they don't want to be governed as before, when the ruling class cannot rule as before, something must happen. Revolts is there. There is a different intertribal wars, which is from above. It is the ruling class is a very minority, the Qajars, like my country, Ethiopia, now, ruled by a insignificant minority elite in alliance with Western imperialism and American imperialism, destroying the country, Ethiopia, selling the land, selling everything, and so on. It remembers me when I go deep to study on Iran. It is the same situation that is of my country, Ethiopia, what's happening. It is a multinational like it is. It's an old country, and so on. I will not go next time. We'll talk about that. But it really remembers me. I see the panorama because I was active once in the student movement, and so on. I see myself when I read Iran, and makes me enjoy, in fact. It is a very rebellious people, very independent people who have never been colonized, who really have another ambition, and so on, despite of the social classes. Finally, the Qajar have to go. A young man who had been in the army, the Qajar Shah, the third of the first, put him in power, an Albanian origin, by origin. Oriza Shah comes, the father of Shah. Muhammad Ali of Egypt is Albanian. Until the final king of Egypt was also originally Albanian. So this minority Albanians played an important role. Shah also is Albanian by origin. That's why I distribute the nationality thing in order to see. So the minority regime of the Qajaris collapsed in 1941. Before 1941. And Shah, the father, Reza Shah, took over. By this time, already Iran became an exclusive monopoly of British imperialism. The Tsarists were defeated, Soviet Revolution happened, and so on. So Britain took over. And Iran is a semi-colony of Britain. In 1908, they discovered the oil in Ibadan, and they created a name for it, which is called Anglo-Iranian, but have nothing to do with Iran. It is the English who are eating everything, the British who are eating. They are the one who are pumping the oil. They are the one who eats. They are the one who have the money. The only thing of Iranian, the oil is Iranian, and the workers are Iranian. There is no other thing of it is Iranian. The logo is called Anglo-Iranian. They penetrated deep, the British. Reza Shah, he visited Turkey of Ataturk. He realized certain things and then brought a new slogan. One nation, one language, one culture. Defeated every organization or organization, tribal organization. Disarmed them in the rural areas, unified, created a new policy in the region, start appointing from the center governors, district commissioners, and so on, from the center. And he says, no, all this squabbling and fighting and so on, there will be one language, one nation, one country called Iran. And what he did is that, one of his moves, which angered the British, is the man, the director general, sitting in the treasury and finance of Iran was a British man. Reza Shah, he said, in this house, there will be only one Shah, not two Shah. So he chased away this British man. He took over. This angered the British imperialists because it was for them, is disorganized Iran and the Qajari type, it was good for them. They are playing. They were the only one who are dancing tango in Tehran. Tehran is created by the Qajars. Urbanization grew, education grew in that process. He also sent the people finally, and after in 1941, the British They cooked something against him and they say he's collaborating too much with the Germans because German capital becoming very strong and penetrating via Turkey and so and so and so on. And the British was frightened. So they chased him and brought his son. His son is the one who toppled 1979 Popular Revolution, Muhammad Reza Shah Pahlavi. He came, he showed himself a little bit modern, he continued a little bit on the Majlis. The most important part of Iranian history, in a modern Iranian history, started under him. Finally, in the Majlis, they agree. They created constitution, which is still in debate, but they also created the Constitutional Assembly, but also the Election Commission. This is becoming visible. On the other side, in 1941-42, the first Communist Party of Iran today was created, emerged. The communists, gradually working from 1920s on and so on, they are the first who created also the trade union, which becomes also important, that workers are increasing in number and so on, factories are coming and so on and so on. Finally, officially, the party came by 1941, end of 41-42, the Communist Party of Iran. The Communist Party of Iran, until its demise and repression, became one of the strongest communist party in the Middle East. Combatant and the strongest one. Of course, Reza Shah, the father of Shah, his policy was against the communists, and always talking, and all forces also agree with him, the bazaar bourgeoisie and the others. These communists, they are agents of Russia, of the Soviet Union, and this and this, and the campaign was against them. But finally, at one time, when the son came and he wanted to consolidate his power and so on, and to show that he is a little bit liberal and so on, allowed an election. Communist was liberal mullahs, segment of liberal intelligentsia, certain small industrialists who wanted independence, and so on, allied. And finally, there was an election, and this election, Musaddiq was elected as a prime minister. The slogan, the most important ally for Musaddiq was the Communist Party of Iran today, which qualitatively brought the consciousness of the Iranian working class and also the progressive and democratic petty bourgeoisie high level. But after his election, here is a very big crime committed against the history and the people of Iran. It's a very sad situation is, which they will never forgive for that. It became part of the psychology of Iranian people. It could have, if Musaddiq was continued, the democratization could have strengthened. Maybe Iran would have taken another road than what she have taken now and what we are now. Kennan, the father of the American policymaker, in 1947, he wrote his policy, which is he's the father of American foreign policy of containment. He says, United States, we in the United States, we are only 6.3% of world population. And we consume 50% of the world wealth. And then he says, our purpose is not to make the gap small, to make the gap bigger. Therefore, he says, we can only use democracy when it suits our interest. We can use only human rights when it suits our interest. So all these are tools we can use it for the big gap to be gap bigger and bigger. And he was addressing later on to the American diplomats who are supposed to be deployed outside, said, don't be naive with this fake human right, democracy, and so on, so on, so on. We are not interested. This is a bullshit idea. The main idea is the gap must be big. A far-sighted man. And that has been applied in Iran in 1953. The Iranians elected Mossadegh, and the first thing Mossadegh did is that nationalizing the Anglo, so-called Anglo-Iranian oil. Until this time, the British were the dominant. Then the Americans came in as go-between, to negotiate between the British and the Iranian. In fact, they didn't come to negotiate. It was for them is a golden opportunity to kick the British and take over Iran. Once they kicked the British, which is a very big loss for Great Britain, they took it over. With Operation Ajax, they overthrow the elected Prime Minister Mossadegh in 1953. And Iran went into coma. Britain was declining. And a declining empire in a fastest rate was declining in the area. Finally, by 1960, she collected her goods and she left the region. It created Qatar, it created United Arab Emirates, and so on, and so on, and so on. And it says, goodbye, I cannot control anything, I'm leaving, I have no appetite anymore, and so on, and I have no that strength anymore, and so on, and they left. Shah became a stooge of American imperialism. Due to the nationalization of the oil, for the first time, Iranian states acquired a lot of money in comparison from the other, in comparison with his father, and in comparison with the Qajars. With the United States, in one side for him, they created for him one of the stronger in the intelligence service, SAVAK, later on became. The main enemy was targeted is the Communist Party of Iran today. Today, in the atmosphere of the Cold War, the Communist Party of Iran is the main enemy. At the same time also, it is a Moscow agent. So the campaign against the Communist Party, it became much higher. And the other side, he knew, he had also enemies, like the bazaar bourgeoisie. Because he represent a new colonial state, and he represent also the comprador bourgeoisie. In the process, he consolidated his power, and so on, he had money, civil servant grow, education, and so on, grow, and so on. Within this civil servant and so on, a comprador bourgeoisie added to it, a bureaucratic bourgeoisie developed in alliance with a comprador bourgeoisie. All main enemy today. Soviet agent, and so on, and so on, and so on. And today was banned and became an illegal party. Shah, he looked around and he saw, okay, the communists are banned, SAVAK is arresting them, they cannot do openly anymore, like in the time they did with Mossadegh and Alliance. The liberal intelligentsia also was shut. Even certain liberal mullahs also were kept aside. In between, I will come to the organization later on, in between, Shah envisaged an idea, the White Revolution. Shah with American advisors, he wanted to do what the communists wanted to do. One of the program of the communists is that it is land reform. Land reform is not a socialist program, it is a bourgeois program. Land reform because there is landless peasant and so and so and so on and this and this. He wants also to attack the bazaar bourgeoisie, which is connected also to a certain extent to landlords, and also to attack the religious qum and so on, which is connected the mullahs who are, he considered, conservative and so on. By 1964 already came in contradiction against the mullahs, and that is why the Qum declaration, which Khomeini also made, and after that he have to be exiled from the country. The Shah's revolution is based on four pillars. One, land reform. Two, women issue, which is his father started. Three, schooling, opening school everywhere, no? Because school was absolutely dominated by the religious institution. And make sure also that it is the religious institution or schools of religious and so on to dwindle, and the children of the peasantry will have a free school and so on, and the prestige of the mullahs will decline. He called it the White Revolution, bringing the war to the mullah's home. That's what he said in one of his interviews. We will kill them with their own virus, he said. It's true, Iran also gradually transformed into a regional power. Working on that in the 70s, with Nixon coming to power, defeat of American imperialism in Vietnam, Nixon's doctrine developed. Nixon's doctrine is to outsource certain policies to regional powers, which is means outsourcing Israel, Turkey, Iran, and my country, Ethiopia. This, they will do the job on their behalf. They don't have to come in front to do the job. Only when it is very dangerous they can come, when it is they really necessarily needed. As long as this, that regional powers do the job, there is no problem. And Iran was inaugurated as a regional police to fight against every revolutionary movement in the Arab world, specific. The Yemen revolution, the Darfur in Oman revolution, militarily intervened, and so on and so on. And he had an alliance with Israel. Israel had a policy that to make always a relationship with non-Arab states, huge non-Arab state in the region, which they call it the faithful triangle, which speaks, Chomsky speaks about it. That is means Iran, Turkey, Ethiopia, my country, and Israel will have an alliance. From the Israeli point of view, to have a relationship, a strong, tight relationship with these countries who are non-Arab, to be an anti-Arab and anti-Palestinian position, which the Shah played that role. Not only that, the Shah had also a very strong relationship with apartheid South Africa. South Africa, apartheid South Africa was condemned and there was an embargo and so on. And Shah, the only country which was selling oil to apartheid South Africa, to the Afrikaners regime in South Africa, was Iran. By that moment, if you are an Iranian and you go to South Africa, you are classified white. I know a friend who was a captain of Iranian ship. He used to go in the time of apartheid to South Africa, and one day, by mistake, he went into a black pub. And then while he's drinking and talking to the blacks, the police came and they said, no, come on, what's your nationality, Iranian? You are not supposed to be here. You have to be into the white pub. The same person in 1979, 80, he went to South Africa. And he went to the same pub. Again, the police came and pulled him. They said, no, no, you are not white. You are black now. You can't go to black. Because just the anecdote, the blackness and the whiteness is very relative to the Afrikaners. And both, this was the alliance at that moment. Other Communist Party is banned. Other new development in Iran in the 60s with Bazargan. Bazargan is a progressive democratic Iranian who is also religious to a certain extent. He developed gradually to build in the embryo by 1962-60 Mujahideen al-Khaliq, the other important movement, the Mujahideen. An Iranian intelligent man, assistant in the University of Tehran, came to study in Sorbonne. He did his PhD in Sorbonne in the beginning of the 60s, 50s, end of 50s and to 60s, supported the Algerian Revolution. He was a very good friend of Sartre. He also met a lot of revolutionaries from Latin America and Africa and so on, Dr. Ali Shariati. Ali Shariati, he changes. Ali Shariati developed later on. He is a man who really affected, you could say, a revolutionary democrat, but also he is developed an ideology or a concept like the liberation theology. Liberation theology of Latin America. He analyzes on the basis of Marxist analysis of classes and so on. And as a young man, he finishes his study and he goes back to Tehran and he starts teaching. Now, Shah starts thinking, Communist Party is banned. Muslim Association and this Mujahideen was developed in the 60s by Bazargan, the first group and so on. And Dr. Ali Shariati coming and teaching his new idea. Shah allowed it. From his perspective, it will move the youth away from the Communist Party today. And maybe this will be an alternative and we can control it. And Ali Shariati became very popular in Tehran University and among the students. So when it reached a very dangerous situation, he exiled him. And the man died as a young man in Syria. And people suspect that it's Savak, the intelligence service, has killed him. A brilliant analysis. And of course, the Mujahideen al-Khaliq also, the first generation was there and so on, was developing this group. But with the influence of Ali Shariati, which we had brought, there was a very intense debate in the universities. Don't forget also, the Iranian student movement in diaspora after 68, it was one of the strongest student movement in the world. Debate isn't. After that is the Ethiopian student movement. And as a result of 68-70s. And from this student movement, and particularly in the Faculty of Engineering, two groups emerged. One group who have studied Marxism and Islam, and particularly Shia history with Ali as a revolutionary, they became the second leaders of the Mujahideen al-Khaliq. It's a petty bourgeois organization, gradually was getting stronger. A militant, it have its own Islamic vision, which is totally different from the bazaar bourgeoisie. A lot of women, militant, and of course, today was always attacked from Reza Shah until now, the arrest, the killing, and all the propaganda that it is the danger of the communists. Iranian communists are pro-Soviet. These are not patriotic. These are, they are foreign agent. And so on and so on. Imagine to live even in underground as a communist in Iran being a member of today is very, very difficult. But it was very brave. They are inside of the trade union, teachers and so on. Clandestinely also learned how to work a lot, despite of one of the strongest intelligence service, one of the strongest intelligence service in the world after the CIA and the British. Huh? You can't compare it with the Belgian one. To live on that tension. Mujahideen al-Khaliq also, they were arrested. The leadership was arrested, harassed by Shah. Shah at the end was getting crazy. He's arresting left and right. In the process, his bureaucracy grew and built very strong army. Spend the wealth of the country. Huh? The country is rich, but he spent it for this. Not only that, at one time Shah gave an open check to Nixon. He said, write whatever you want, I will give you. Because he was the police of the region also. In every meeting of the army generals, Shah must be there. Because he'd never trusted also the army. He knew that it is maybe officers, patriotic officers and so on, they might have. There was also a lot of patriotic officers connected to the Communist Party, connected to Mujahideen, connected to this, because they are Iranians. The army is the embryo of the Iranian society. They come from the different families. They come from different homes, from different regions. They bring stories, they discuss. It's an easy way that it is you bring young people in a barrack and they can discuss. Of course, you have to put intelligence among them. That's another issue. Finally, the Iranian people refused to live as before. And the regime could not rule as before. They are no more afraid. The classes who wanted to mobilize against him, communists, PTB, Mujahideen, workers, syndicates, liberal, including the bazaar bourgeoisie and the ideology of the bazaar bourgeoisie. The bazaar bourgeoisie linked with 100 wires or million wires with Iranian society, with religious school, with mullahs, they use tradition, with the landlord class, and so on. And they are victim of the comprador bourgeoisie. The Shah regime is based on a pure one-person personalistic state added to it with the comprador bourgeoisie and the bureaucratic bourgeoisie. These are the two supporters of him. Third, he doesn't even trust his. So Savak could not arrest, kill. It could not stop the fire of the revolutionary sentiment of Iranian people. The militancy of the Iranian people was very hard, very hard. I'm sure if you could have another Hollywood, you could make hundreds of films about that. It is unbelievable. And of course, the nationality problem was there also, that it is the Azeri question is there, the other, even though it is merging. The land reform was made, but it brought also with the land reform another contradiction by itself. Finally, all classes, the major oppressed classes, allied. And Khomeini was outside in Iraq. Water boils and transforms itself into steam when it reaches a certain degree. Revolution also is like that. 79. By 78, 75, 76, he's having more trouble and starts releasing sometimes political prisoners, and then he brings them back and so on. He doesn't trust the army. He became paranoid. He cannot even trust the Savak, the intelligence. He said, you are infiltrated. Your information is not correct. How is possible the fire is not distinguished? Why the people always are awake? Because he doesn't understand the dialect of history as a ruling class. He only sees force and money. and United States behind him. And the CIA was their analysis and so on. Can you imagine somebody who came from Arizona to make an analysis about Iran? It's a very backward area, or you come from South Carolina, you only know slaves, black slaves and so on, and he went to one school and so on, and he was be appointed in Iran to be and so on. These are white Negroes who doesn't know a lot of things. They are boasting. I don't believe that Western intelligence really have a capacity to analyze us. If they are communists, something else. But others, they are just charlatan, useless. Anyway, their analysis, it could not be. I mean, it is, if you have a pharmaceutical industry and so on, you have chemists and this, and you first try and so on, and then you develop the pill, isn't it? But they could not develop the pill of anti-revolution. History. Barbara Tuchman, an American historian, she says, and she writes her book, The March of Woolley. She says, why politicians, she speaks about imperialist countries, Green, make mistake while they are surrounded by intelligent advisors. Finished from Harvard, finished from Oxford, Cambridge, all these title and so on, advised. Why, she says, let me check in history. When Prime Minister Pitt, the Tories, elected him in Great Britain, to show you how whatever, it's not your ideas which determine, it's the class role plays, the commercial, the mercantile class of Great Britain, we were dominant in the land, dominant in the parliament, in the House of Lords, in the House of Commons in Great Britain. And then they said, no, these Americans, yeah, they have to pay tax. They are colonies of us, and we have to colonize them by their own money. We have to put tax. They wrote the white Americans in the South, Franklin Roosevelt and all this and so on, Benjamin and so on, first they came to meet. They wrote a letter to the Queen. We are white, we love you, we are your citizen, and so on. Why you are putting tax and so on and so on? They send the letter, no answer. Then they gathered in Boston, the tea revolution, which they call the tea party. It came from that. Just to give, then finally they said, we demonstrate. They went to demonstrate. The Tory troops shot them. Oh, there is also killing. We thought we are white. Then Benjamin Franklin, they told him, you have to go. Maybe all these who are doing, those who are in the middle, the Queen, she doesn't know. So you have to go and visit the Queen and tell her how we love her and why she is hurting, why they are hurting us. He came. He made an appointment for House of Commons, Benjamin Franklin. When he wanted to enter in the Parliament at the road, the guard, first he took his handkerchief. He said, wait over there, you smell. Because these cowboys, they smell, have no manner of table, they are vagabonds and so on. That is the concept, the cultural concept in the ruling class in Great Britain at that moment. So finally they said, bring the cowboy, so stand there, distance. All of them, they took their handkerchief. And then he read, but unfortunately, France was defeated in the War of Canada. And lost Canada for Great Britain. And she was very angry, waiting. French intelligence knew this man was coming. So when he was disappointed, they brought him to France, and France supported him in that way. So her book continues until Vietnam. She said, why? And then she came to conclusion, you can't stop history, she said, whatever intelligent you are. You might delay it, but you can't stop history. What happened in Iran is all classes gang up on this man and the comprador class and so on. The spontaneous, the different spontaneous revolution, all the rivers came together and they became a very big sea. Khomeini, he had also his own vision. An individual, intelligent man, a theologian, who he believes in the sovereignty. He doesn't like imperialism and domination from outside. He was in exile in Iraq. So when the revolution was continuing, Iraq kicked him out, he came to France. The alliance now, Mujahideen, also an Islamic organization. Islam in a sense of liberation theology type. They mix Marxism with Islam. The main enemy today, the Communist Party. The other enemy also, enemy for all of them, or enemy which is considered at that moment, Mujahideen al-Khaliq became a petty bourgeois. They have some working class background. They are for women rights and so on, a little bit modern. But they grew because it is the communists. They were banned. They were also arrested, harassed, and so on. Finally, they allied. They thought, this old man, he have no organization. But he's popular. So every speech of him, they used to put in CD and smuggle it into the country. And he became popular in the country, the man. Finally, when Iraq kicked him, they received him in Paris. Then, when the revolution happened, if you remember in the news, he comes with Alitalia or whatever big plane, arrives in Tehran, and he kissed the ground, and he uttered one word, Hezbollah. The war started. He represents, and his philosophy is for the bazaar bourgeoisie. The bazaar bourgeoisie is the most organized, connected with thousand wires with the Iranian people. After that, immediately, he called Rafsanjani and the others and so on, created his own group. A 1980 election happens. And in Tehran, the biggest number of the election and people who have voted liberal and Mujahideen al-Khaliq. And then they made the contradiction came because he did his Hezbollah. And the May Day demonstration ended the small understanding between them, and Khomeini went into offensive, arrest, kill, and so on. To conclude, Khomeini, the Iraqi war, also this unfortunate war between Iraq and Iran, it helped. One, you could crush anybody and everything. Iranians are very nationalist and patriotic force. They said, no other discussion. The battle is to defend the nation. In process, build the passage, the militia force. They took over certain segment. They left Shah's bureaucracy and they eliminated those who are not with them. They brought in or anybody who can travel with them, the intelligentsia who wants to leave and so on, they brought them. They didn't fight with them. And they continued the war. And Khomeini refused also ceasefire with Iraq until 1988. In 1988, with the Battle of Fau, that Khomeini have died, Rafsanjani becomes the leader. For United States, it was the biggest disaster and the loss of the 20th century to lose Iran. Until now, as the Iranian people will never forgive United States for what they did against Mossadegh and that revolution, United States dreams, and until now didn't recover from that hangover and loss. A very important country, situated in a very strategical place. the second biggest gas reserve in the world, the third oil, old history, big strategically important. Caspian Sea on there, down until the Persian Sea or the Arab Sea, until Hormuz. Rasfanjani, he is from the bazaar class. Rasfanjani, after him, he was twice elected, and after that, another, the same group of him came, I forgot his name. This time it's called the liberal, not liberal you could say. They are also, Rasfanjani is one of the richest men in Iran, and he dominates the pistache economy. They have a very huge amount of. Now, the state of Iran is in the hand of the bazaar bourgeoisie in alliance with the religious leaders. They envisage a new constitution. Khomeini, when they were making the slogan in the time of the struggle, when they say the slogan was, we want a democratic republic, Khomeini, he said, no, we want Islamic republic. It's, in a class sense then, it's clear, to whom Islamic republic? He knew his target very clearly, very shrewd politician. Apart from being, he developed a theory within the Shia theology, which is called Wilayat al-Faqih, the guardian, and developed his own Islam. Of course, they are not the same as the Wahhabis who are anti-women and so on and so on. He developed his theory of Wilayat al-Faqih. Wilayat al-Faqih means is that it is the missing Mahdi, which is the 12 imams, at Na'ashariya, what they call Ja'fariyin. The last imam, he disappeared, and he will come as a Mahdi. But if he disappeared, there must be a communication between the people and the Mahdi. And that is called the Bab. So this, the Wilayat al-Faqih, they are the communication between the missing Mahdi and the people. This is from whom theological point of view. Iran also became a sovereign country. You can't harass Iran. They don't take assistance from anybody. There is no 11-11 action for Iran. There is no MSF. There is no Brudluk Delen there. There is no all these rubbish things in Iran. They are independent states. They don't beg, they do business. So what happened is, this Rasfanjani, until Iran after the revolution, United States and Iran, they have broke the relationship. It is the Swiss were the one who are control or looking for the American interest, but for United States, it is a big loss. In 2012, I will come later, or no, before I get 2012, I have to conclude, then Ahmadinejad. Ahmadinejad was elected twice, and every day there was in our news about Ahmadinejad. Ahmadinejad, 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 Ahmadinejad. Some people even, they thought it is a new name. They have just given his name. They said it's Ahmadinejad. Because a mother, she told me, too much I heard about him, he must be very good. I gave my son his name. Ahmadinejad is for state intervention. He says the state must be strong. And every contract must be dealt from the center. Ahmadinejad is against Rasfanjani. Even he attacked Rasfanjani as a thief. Ahmadinejad also believed that it is the bazaar bourgeoisie is not paying. That lot of money of the bazaar bourgeoisie is not known for the state. So Ahmadinejad, he said, I wanted to know every Iranian to have chips like we have here. That everything in this country, if you wanted to know about anybody, go to the Ministry of Finance. So he says, every Iranian, whatever he earns, and so on, and so on, and so on, we can only know when we do this. The nuclear which was built in Iran, He's also Ahmadinejad. He is not from the mullah. He is an engineer. He studied in from that engineer faculty of Tehran. He is a professor also now. And he is also from those engineers, young people who were debating in the time of the Shah. He is one of the people also took over the embassy of United States. So Ahmadinejad have another vision. The imperialist media was daily was attacking because he wanted to strangle Iran from inside. That is the difference between what they call conservative and progressive. Rafsanjani, Rabbani, and Rouhani, they are this line. Of course, they will not relinquish the power or something the state power must be, but to allow investment. On the other side, he says investment we are not against. We have to be independent, and we have, of course, all of them agree also to a certain extent on the nuclear energy, which United States built it for Shah, and to get more energy and so on and sell their thing. Ahmadinejad also had an independent vision in international relation, an alliance with Latin America, joining with the Shanghai group and so on, his relationship with Russia and all this, because Iran is a very important geographically and so very important country, and there is a lot of wealth in that country, more than 70 million of a population and so on. It's not a very small country of 1 million like Qatar. It determines an historically very important country of the region. They can make a difference if they have succeeded in 1953, and that's why it is it was an abortion what happened. Anyway, that is the vision of Ahmadinejad. The other thing, the Americans gave a gift to Iran, the unintended consequence of American policy. 11 September happened. This PNAC, the American Century Group, some of them came from a Trotskyist background and so on. They rejected Brzezinski, they rejected all the other theoreticians, and they said, yeah, we use 11 September as a pretext and we will invade Afghanistan, but the main objective was Iraq. When they invaded Afghanistan and the Taliban melted down, they couldn't build an Afghani government. They were in a trap. They know how to invade, to destroy, like a gang, but they were in a trap. After that, okay, today you did this and tomorrow. They looked around, they said, oh, Iran, help us. They turned to Iran. Iran is the one who organized the conference in Geneva of all Afghani forces and individuals, and Iranian diplomacy played the most important role to create. Without the Iranians, there will never be Afghanistan government. That is one side. Second side, it is Laylatul Qadr, as there is before Ramadan, there is 1 week, very important week. If you walk in the street here and suddenly it is dark, somebody, an angel talking to you, he asks you only 2 questions. What do you want? And what is your wish? And if you say, I want to be the richest person in Belgium, which is more than Albert Frere, the next day you will be. But you have to think good. This is a date, it is Islamic day, Laylatul Qadr. The Qadr means is something happened from God, a very strong thing comes. I call that war in Afghanistan for Iran is a gift, non-intended gift. It made Iran, within 24 hours, a regional power. American troops and NATO troops, they can only, apart from the Afghani resistance attacking them, if they go a little bit more against Iran, in 1 week time, all of them will die. Iran can play, send weapons and fighters there in Afghanistan, they look the same, they can destroy NATO within 10 days. So you need to respect Iran. On the top of that, they are so crazy, they attacked Iraq. They destroyed the Baath Party. Who came to power? Iranian friends. So Iran became automatically from a weak country into a regional power. And now the biggest threat with Iraq and Iran is the biggest threat. Not only that, they are intelligent, these mullahs. Don't see whom turban. Behind the turban, their brain is functioning. Intelligent brains. Slowly building Hezbollah, supporting Hezbollah from 1982 and so on. 2006, we have seen the theater. What happened to the Zionist state? Alliance with Syria, and today also they are doing. That is Iran. In 2012, after Obama coming to power, in all this absence, American bourgeoisie, segment of American bourgeoisie, made it its own analysis. While we are always saying Iran, it is dead, and we will have fight terrorism, and these Zionist lobbies, and so on, our market was taken by others. Russians, Chinese, this, even, and then United States imposed on Europeans. No trade with Iran. Any European company makes trade, we will discover and we'll put it in the black list, and then he will not get any access to the American market. So this concept 6+1, negotiation continued. The Zionists have they don't shout anymore. We don't hear also that it is going to the General Assembly with a picture and a bomb that Iran will destroy the world and so on. The theater man of Tel Aviv, he doesn't talk anymore. American firms from telecommunication, agriculture, and so on, they criticize Obama, and they criticize all the others. They say Iran is a big market, while others are taking from us, and we are here dancing like Red Indians, and they are taking our market. Shut up. Agree with Iran. When Kerry came in Oman to give you the last touch of this discussion, and I will stop here if you have any question, he came with 480 business people. Conclusion, Little Flanders also had opened an office in Tehran for business. So there is a lot to eat from the Persian dish. If you have any question, the future time will determine. Thank you.
Please, if you have questions, come to the fore, and we'd like you to use the microphone. I'm sure there's questions, don't be afraid.
Dus wat nu aan de gang is in Syrië, ik denk dat dat van geweldig groot belang is en dat men eigenlijk hier in België, in het Westen eigenlijk niet begrijpt wat dat daar eigenlijk de inzet van is. En dat men eigenlijk niet ziet Iran, Irak en dan Syrië en dan Libanon, dat dat één grote streep gaat worden, anti-imperialistische streep gaat worden, hoop ik, denkt Hoopt je dat ook, of is het inderdaad een beetje wishful thinking dat vanuit het Midden-Oosten met die snelingstekens shiïtische stroming het imperialisme op zijn donder gaat krijgen?
What I listen whole year about Iran, I don't know about Iran a lot. And you said that in these coming days, in the past, which are most good friends, then they are enemies and then once again become friends. But in this whole thinking in new, according to Afghanistan, Middle East and South Asia, if Iran become once again the policeman of the South Asia, and in the great game, the new players, which are China, India, Pakistan, and other Central Asian states. What do you think that if America become a friend with Iran, and what will happen the other regional powers, which are also playing in the great game, what will happen? After one secondary question, if Beirut, Baghdad, Sana'a, and of course Tehran, they are become one according him, that I don't say sheet or something, but I'm saying the encircling the energy power, then if become Iran the police state once again, what will happen with other players which are in great game now? Thank you.
Let's start with this one.
First of all, you cannot choose to be an ally. An ally have a class character. When the ruling class, which is ruling any country for that matter in that part of the world, is a comprador, dependent, gets oxygen from outside, incubated by outside, breathes from outside, thinks from outside, yes, you can be a friend. United States have no friend, have only interest. And there is no in politics friends, only interest. To bring back Iran to 1953 before, that's an illusion, and it will be a dream. What United States wants, with the crisis, economical crisis she have and everything, to have a share of Iranian market. Maybe hoping one day a change will come in Iran, but her main objective is to eat something from Iranian market. That is one. Second, if it is possible gradually infiltrate the thinking of Iranian youth and Iranian so-called others who hate the existing regime and so on and so on. But that is a very long. The pillar of the regime of Iran, one is the bazaar bourgeoisie with its connection. Second is its own bureaucracy, which even though they used the bureaucracy of Shah, but they put under control. They have a very strong intelligence service, very strong army. If you are not able to infiltrate for the last 36 years, it will take you decades to do that homework. American bourgeoisie also, an American capitalist is interested in business now, because it's losing everywhere because of a rigid 2012 in the conference of Bali in Indonesia of the ASEAN countries. Obama has made his policy speech. He says United States is not an Atlantic power, it is an Asian power. other important. The biggest economy in the world is not in Europe or in America. Both combined, they are not the biggest. It's the biggest economy is Asia. And there is also important powers there. I give you an example. India and Iran 6 years ago made an agreement. An agreement that there will be a pipeline from Iran will bring energy until India. This frightened the United States. Despite of the contradiction between Pakistan and India. Suppose this pipeline comes to India. The relationship between Pakistan and India will be better. Anyway, after all, they are cousins. Pakistan also have a very big reserve of gas in Balochistan. United States did everything to block it. But it will happen. There are things United States cannot do. It is over of the past. They had failed miserably in Iraq. Iran didn't spend even a penny to have indirectly influence in Iraq. Second, can Iran be a police of United States? I don't think Iran can be a condom of United States from now on. The era of condom is over for such countries like in Iran. They must invent a special condom, which me and you, which we have never seen. They can invade? That is another absolutely craziness. The Saudis who are pushing that line. The Saudis, the Wahhabists, and House of Saud, despite of the wills they have, they want to confuse the region and the Muslim people and to create a division between Sunnis and Shias and create a war among the Muslims. You can only weaken them by creating war, divide and rule. There is an American guy, a Zionist, from a Jewish background. He published a book about 10 years ago, 8 years ago. It's called The Persian Puzzle, like the Syrian puzzle. When you read his book, the agreement now Iran have signed with United States, and he was advising United States, in the book, that it was a carbon copy. He says, it's not good to go into contradiction and to direct confrontation with Iran. We will only lose, we will not win. We have to be there, even though we are not invited into the wedding. But at least we can sleep in. So at this moment, I think, as I have mentioned, the comprador, it's not a comprador bourgeoisie connected from outside. It has to be a miracle. A lot of change must come in Iran. And the regime is very strong. I don't see any indication for the moment that they have a serious problem. Second, they are not dependent. The relation between Syria and Iran, it's a strategic relation. Because they call it the force of resistance. And the logic is, if we remove the Syrian puzzle, we will weaken Hezbollah and Iranian friends there, and we also quarantine Iran in its place. So the logic comes then, the conclusion, the Ba'ath must be overthrown. And the analysis comes is, the Ba'ath is a group of Alawites, and they are minority, and if the majority so-called Sunnis and so on revolt, the Ba'ath will melt like ice cream. I have never seen an ice cream we didn't melt for 5 years. And it is as hot as here. They lost also miserably there. Israel have an interest to weaken the Arab army. Did she succeed? I don't believe. The musiba, as the Muslims they call the Arabs, the musiba or the bad thing I wish for you, it could turn positive. The experience of the Syrian army, which is built to fight a normal conventional war, they impose on them to fight a guerrilla war. What a tremendous experience they had. Now they know how to fight a guerrilla war. So, then Russia. United States now is targeting Russia through her NATO to encircle Russia and so on and so on. Well, the Russians also have their own answer. The probability for war, a dangerous war, is there. Here, fundamental things come. The German question again comes back in the European history. It's not the Belgians who endangers Russia, or it is not Luxembourg, or it is not Holland, or the small Danish and this and this and this. These are irrelevant, even the French. United States is pushing Germany. Wants Germany to put her boots in the Baltic states and so on. The issue is now comes for Europe. The German question again come back. I don't know, we will see. What I'm saying is that it is this, maybe possible, but the issue is that the German question came back. European history, modern European history you want to study, don't study about the small ones. I mean 4 million Danish, who are 90% are peasant and so on. You study about them, it will only cost you time. I think the real issue today in Europe, and maybe next year we will have one very good discussion, the German question. That the working class here must understand. That their marja'iyas, as they call in the their parties, what they analyze. The German question is there. With its Deutschmark, with its Euro, with its this, with its this, with its this. Did they will go to the Russian line? Did Britain is moving out? She says, I don't know. America says, no, don't move, stay. You will help us from inside. What will be the reaction of the French? That will be another discussion. But to come to China, Pakistan, and first of all, the most strategical friend for Pakistan is not United States, it's China. From the inception, since day one, when Ali Jinnah created the Pakistan state, the relationship between Pakistan and China, it is not tactical, it is a strategical relationship. You attack Pakistan, China will go to war. Put that full stop there. Whatever the Pakistani bourgeoisie maneuvers, main strategy, the red line will never be crossed, is with China. Second, the Indian bourgeoisie. The Indian bourgeoisie had its lesson. 8,000 kilometer border between China and India was not demarcated when India got independent. The British left it for future war. Nehru, Americans approached him in the 60s, despite India's main relationship in industry, in the steel industry, and military, and so on, was with the Soviet Union. He wanted a green revolution to fight against famine, which is the legacy of British colonialism. And in this green revolution, they supported him, the Americans, which succeeded. That is, now you go to Punjab, 20% of the grains of India was produced in Punjab. What was the condition of the Americans was to accept when Dalai Lama escaped to come to India. He refused India. He said, I will put it in Nepal, which is also my small province. I will put him there, not directly in India, that we will have a lot of cameras and photos they will take from him. It's better there, and there is the Tibetan origin there, in Nepal. He made one strategical mistake, which India made. 1964, India-China War, 63-64, while China was in Cultural Revolution. Chinese defeated Indian army and captured thousands. This brought a lot of debate with the Indian Communist Party, and then split the Naxalite, the Maoist, Charu Mazumdar, and then they started their armed struggle. You cannot export war, you see. War is not a commodity. War is a dangerous game. It's like love. Yeah. If you are in love, you can be crazy. War also is a dangerous thing. You cannot export. You can only do it in a stage of people are in semi-primitive society and disorganized. Russia, Iran is member of the Shanghai. It has a very good relationship, cordial relationship with China. It is very, for United States, of course, Iran is very important. The Caspian Sea, Central Asia, and so on, and so on, and so on. They wish that Iran becomes friend of them. They will kiss the ass of the Iranians. It is the best place where you can stop Russia, you can stop China, you can... Subhanallah. What a place. It is really the real tango you can play there. And Putin have good friends. It's not Brussels, which Molenbeek defeated. Very important country. Very important strategically. Other. Iran will remain, I don't know now, what I don't know, I will not tell you, but I suspect that the ruling class in Iran, with all its alliances had made, and the way they play, now, the Hezbollah disappeared, they don't speak about it. The way they play in diplomacy, the way they integrate their intelligentsia in the top and so on, because the things is cooked somewhere else. The way they manage it, they are not the mullahs of the 15th century. They are the mullahs of Nasrullah. I mean, if you add all Western Cambridge, Harvard, all these universities, they don't reach the shoes of Nasrullah. His analysis, his brilliancy, his knowledge of the world. So it is a big transfer. You need to have to cheat now as before, that is gone. As Palmudud, he says. I will stop here if you have any.
If you don't mind, I have a question which is not taking place actually. Okay. By the way, thank you for this enlightenment information that I received from you. Is another perspective. I've never saw it in that way. Anyway, you try to picture Iran as a strong country. Okay, I believe in some cases, yeah, you've got it right. But if you want to put
those and other factors which dividing the country by the base of the ethnical group. You didn't actually talk about it. Iran is vulnerable in that case. That's the first thing that I wanted that be answered, if there is an answer for it. And secondly, the age of the supreme leader, which is very concerned right now in Iran, gonna have a great effect on the future of Iran and those forces which are gonna be, in my opinion, gonna define the future of Iran. Would you please explain on that matter?
In the beginning, and that's why I gave you also the paper, to have the panorama of the nationalities in Iran. This had been a long debate among the communist and progressive Iranians. I will not speak, if that by itself is a title to discuss alone the nationality question in Iran and in Pakistan, then you can expand it to other places. The debate of the Communist Party of Iran today, the debate of Mujahideen on the nationality question, the debate of the liberals and so on, it's lovely. Multinational countries, diversity of language and religion is not a weakness, it's a richness. It's a blessing. I am happy to be born in a country of 80 languages and 80 nationalities live. It's a blessing. I speak several languages of that country. I know the different cultures and values. It makes you the most mature human in school, in the boarding schools, we were mixed, and so on and so on. Despite in our debates, in the student movement, and so on, nationality question is after the class question was very, very important as in Iran. In Iran, the mullahs are not stupid, smart. My class enemy, they are, but they are smart. I give them the credit. What they did? Islamic democracy, on the basis minorities will be allocated affirmative actions. Including Iranian Jewish, they have representation in the Majlis. Armenian Orthodox, they have representation. Assyrian, they have representation. Sunnis, they have this and so on. Of course, a nation, and a multinational nation, you can only build it in a revolutionary basis. The revolutionary class can build a new multinational state. Look, Belgium. They have 550 parliamentarians, 55 ministers. China have only 25. Look, China, there is about a billion and almost 300 million population. China is also 55 nationalities, minority nationalists exist in China. The biggest Western Han, the others exist. This problem will remain as long as it gets its medicine. It's a fundamental question which cannot be solved in any bourgeois concept. It's a homework for the revolutionaries in Iran to do. But the mullahs fixed something, put their Sharia, which is the old system, until now they are managing, and they put there and there. And there is no very big resistance against them until now. The future, I don't know what will happen. For a country, it's important to be as democratic as possible in order to create. But the embryo, not the embryo, the root of being Iran here is big. Beyond the nationalities problem. Iran is the two major nationality are Farsi speakers and Azeri speakers. Then you have the others. Can it threaten militarily, or can imperialism can use that? If imperialism try to use that, it will fail. Because nationalism, the patriotism of Iranian people is deeper than that. That's the way, and I checked and tried to analyze. Even Azerbaijan, when it became independent, and now have oil and so on, and there is an Azeri dictator ruling, they have a lot of money. There are a lot of Azeris from Azerbaijan who have money here. They get their nationality while they are in Azerbaijan. No? They live in the richest villa, which we never meet them. They are there. They didn't even could establish a serious state called Azerbaijan. Men thought that it will pull the Azeris of Iran, and then engineers will go there, and so it didn't happen. So I don't know what will happen to Iran. That we will wait and see. Probably the younger generation will see better. But it is, I think, for the moment, I don't see. The other thing is that it is, they don't discriminate like Shah. Shah, he tried to create racism and so on and this and this. I think this ones they manage, and even generals, important people in the army are from different nationalities. They are even important Arabs from Arbustan of the FIFA and so on and so on. So I think they are faster, they see things. I'm not supporting theirs, but they are not banana republic as it's called and so on. And they will not dawl with this, I think. Yes.
The third minority, the Kurds, they have their armed resistance against the state. It's
and
not.
And the same Balochis. If there are greater Balochistan conspiracy which are now, because in Pakistan they are already fighting for a long time. Now the third uprising in Pakistan.
Good. We start with the Kurd, and then the Turkmen, and then we end with the Baluchis. The second biggest Kurd population live, they are Iranians, after Turkey. It's true, there were also a lot of Kurds in the Communist Party of today. Huh? It's true Kurds are Indo-European language speakers, but they are not Shiite, they are Sunni. Turkoman also to a certain extent. The more capitalism grows with the Rouhanis and so on, if it continues, the more same capitalism and the bourgeoisie, they live in the market. The more the market become bigger and bigger, of course the Kurdish bourgeoisie will ask its own market and share from the cake. And how you ask? One of the reasons is that you fight for the right of self-determination. You take a gun. Now the issue will be for the Kurd to analyze what they call the rapport de force in the country. Not necessarily by taking a gun, you will impose your will on the other one if the other also nationalities in Iran also must feel the same like the Kurd. In a multinational country, if you think only of your egoism, yourself, my nationality, and you don't have the connection with the other nationalities and other forces, you could be crushed, and you can pay even there. Now you are asking me, if I will be a Kurd, I'm not living in Iran, and I'm not a Kurd, I cannot judge. But the Kurd bourgeoisie, which now is developed within Iran, do you think will ascribe a Kurd to an armed struggle? Because the different social classes in Kurdistan have their own different aspirations. The Piti bourgeoisie have another aspiration. The Kurdish bourgeoisie have their own aspiration. The Agas and the Khan have another aspiration, and so on and so on. So the peasantry equation, all this. I never came across to read, despite of their number was big, when I compare it with the Iraqi Kurd, the Iranian Kurd organization is not as strong as Iraqi. So, subjective factor with sentiment. Subjective factor means the organization and the sentiment and the mobilization and the capacity you need. I can think of wishful thinking. I came from an oppressed nationality. My father was a resistance man, my grandfather was a resistance man, and so on. I know this nationality business, how it goes. But you need certain qualities. If you don't have that qualities and objective condition doesn't allow you, even the people will not go with you because they don't want to sacrifice what they have. So I don't know the condition there. To come to I will give you one anecdote. When the Armenians played a very important role in Iran, because they are the one who brought also revolutionary ideology and this and this and this, and they were a little bit privileged by the foreign powers. They had their own private schools and so on and this, because they are Christians. But when the Armenian movement in Turkey, when he began, the young people like him and so on, 10 people, discussed and created their own. And then they went to Istanbul to talk to the patriarch, the Armenian patriarch, offered them baklava and tea and so on. He said, Osei, my sons, he said, what you are going to tell me? Oh, they told him, my friend, patriarch, we want you to give us the blessing. Blessing for what? We want to liberate Armenia. He just laughed. He said, come. He took them out. He's in Istanbul. He opened the door and said, come on, he said, do you see that bank? It's an Armenian bank. Do you see that hotel? It's an Armenian. That you see supermarket is an Armenian. Armenian, 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 everything Armenian. He said, where is the Turk? Fallahin, they are farmers. He said, which Armenia you are liberating? Nationalism sometimes can be a suicidal. When you don't know, they lost everything. Armenians now, the richest Armenians are Iranian Armenians. You see, it's not, wishful thinking is very dangerous. This is an advice, not to commit suicide. There is a movement created by United States in Balochistan. Balochistan, Pakistan. And Balochistan, Iran, the Baluchis live in a very big geographical zone in Iran. In Pakistan, 45% of Pakistan inhabited by Baluchis. And they only constitute 5% of the total population. and they live in the best place. You touch their ground, water comes up, gas, everything. And all this until Gadwar, which is the, now the Chinese built a very important harbor in Pakistan, one of big container harbor is Baluchis. Jundullah, the so-called soldier of Allah, which tried to kill some bombed Iranian soldiers, killed a general and something. Sometimes they put an ambush there and there. This is supported by United States. You know, there are certain nationalities. Their understanding of being afraid and their bravery is very high. If I was a Belgian, whether it's a French speaker or a Dutch speaker, and you tell him or you bring him there to Balochistan and so on, and you say, we have to liberate this. He will just look at that. He said, well, you must go to psychiatry. You are crazy. A huge army Pakistan here and a huge army Iran here. No way you can succeed. Baluchis could do that. Like, imagine now to tell you. This is imperialism analyzes the psychology of people. Chechens. There are 1 million people. The elderly, the children, the women, and there are only 1 million. This is the people who took the opera of Moscow. You remember? The war in Grozny. Then I said, how is possible? Then I said, certain nationalities in the world, their psychology is bigger than their number. They are not afraid to die. And imperialism analyzes that and uses them. But if their consciousness increases with the political work, they can turn against imperialism in a very dangerous way. Balochistan is the link American imperialism thinks if we create problem for Iran and Balochistan and for Pakistan and remove out Balochistan from both countries, they will have the control the Persian Gulf or the Arab Gulf, and they will control oil and gas. And they can be the new Afghanistan of the British in the 18th, 19th century. Is it possible to realize that? I don't think so. It's just only crazies and can do that. And I will, if I'm a Baluchi, I will make this speech. Even if they kill me, I know my people. I will tell them, don't send your children to this danger. This is gambling. We want school, we want health system, we want this. We don't want to die for somebody's war. If they wanted to fight against the, Iran and so, they go and fight. We give them a ring and they can fight with box and so on there in the ring. But why? I think the Baluchi people will understand that. But it is created by United States, which later on they will drop them. They did also with Hamong in Laos and so on, with all other small people, mountain people in Vietnam and so on. One of the most important you have to see, I conclude, Comrade Ho Chi Minh, he knew Vietnam and he knew his people, the Viet. He came from the Viet nationality, which they constitute 70% of the total population. But there are other nationalities in Vietnamese who live in the mountains. And the other Viets look at them like dogs, untouchables of Vietnam. What he did, comrade. When he came and to fight and to start the armed struggle against the French, first he went and he lived with them. Not only he lived, he knew the French can use them because they have historical grievances against the majority and can use them as a fifth column to fight the Viet people, to fight Vietnam in general. as a country. So he went there, he lived with them, and married from the untouchable. What a great man. That is the work of a revolutionary. To tell to the vets, fuck off, these are Vietnamese also, and I married from them, and I have a son. He had only one son. The mother, yesterday, feudal Vietnam, she was untouchable. So a revolution also, you don't only make it, but also you make on yourself. Cultural revolution. In that sense, I appeal for my brothers in Balochistan. I can imagine their aspiration, but I tell them, don't take a suicidal war. Then will be the end of the Baluchis. They are only 5% in a big area, 45% of Pakistan. Can they fight against the Pakistani regime? A such strong army? That's crazy. On this occasion, I tell them, don't dance with Uncle Sam. Dance with your neighbor. And thank you very much. I have one thing to tell you. For those people who wanted to read, one thing I forgot. There was also a Maoist movement. A Maoist movement. After Mujahideen and Khalid, the same time a Maoist movement was created. And for armed struggle in Iran. And they tried and they were killed. Behzad Jezani is the chairman. And this is his book, published by Zed. A brilliant young man. His analysis of Iranian society, which is in a lot of things still viable. You can write for people you want. Another, this Iranian from an Armenian nationality. Probably, I think he is now a professor in America, but I suspect or I will not mention, it's not important, but he knows very much about Iran and particularly on the Communist Party of Iran and the Mujahideen al-Khaliq. He published two books. This is on the Mujahideen. This is his book, Eloquent Analysis. The second book of him is called Iran Between Two Revolutions. A masterpiece. You read that, nobody will tell you stories. The issue is, we have all of us brain. Let's give 5 minutes to our brain and study our environment. Finally, I appeal to you. My neighbor country, Eritrea. Because it had independent policy and national independence. And because it had a vision for Eritrea and for the region. Not like the regime in Ethiopia. It is, as I have told you, a minority regime like Qajar, which gets its oxygen from the CIA. Who? Ethiopia is the 25th African country in the world, with population and with growth. Ethiopia is not a poor country, it is a country of poor people. And these poor people didn't have a leadership to change the life of them. The regime, in alliance with external enemy, is looting and destroying the country. And because of the experience of Eritrea, Ashomsky says, the second man who have taken over in the time when Kennan left Foreign Office in the United States, he developed a theory. He says the most dangerous country is so-called poor and small country. And his analysis is, if this poor and small country, by accident of history, have an intelligent revolutionary leadership, is very dangerous. Dangerous because they change the life of the people in that country and they improve the life of the people in that country. And then those countries who are big, endued with a lot of wealth, The people of that country who are in a miserable situation, when they look to this small country and is doing better, they will think, he says. And if they think, the first, then organization, and they will struggle others. They are talking about Cuba, the rotten apple theory. If you put an apple and one rotten one, it will contaminate. That's why cut the rotten apple. All the embargoes, the assassination against Castro, and all this. When they didn't succeed themselves, they went there. The same situation on Eritrea. We started a campaign. Now, the last 2 years, the United States is changing every time because it controls all these so-called UN bodies and so on, and these congressional states. And now, they are the Human Rights Commission in Geneva 2 years ago. They have appointed a rapporteur against Eritrea. And now even they want to release the report without other people to study and so on, because majority of the nations have rejected it. We started a campaign, signature campaign, handoff from Eritrea. Please, those who are interested, can you sign and you give me back? And thank you very much for listening to my boring story, and thank you, bye.